a warm Open Group in Dublin welcome, please, for Johan Krebers.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. So we're going to talk about really what is OD all about. Why do we need something like an open subsurface data universe in the oil and gas industry? And also what's all about the role of Open Group and where we are and how we're moving forward. So it's really give a state from a background and where we are and how we're moving forward in this space. Let's first give a little bit of history. It's really, if you look at a typical oil and gas company, as much in the subsurface space, subsurface is really the space where you try to find your oil and gas futures. Yeah, subsurface is really where you go out there, shooting your seismic, collecting that data, going to the development phase, and try to get wells out there to start producing it. So that whole part today is very much in a siloed environment over there. Yeah, so you've got data is linked to applications. First one. So you've got many, the data is very intrinsically part of an application out there. Therefore, data is stored in many silos. So there's not really a lineage out there. What does that mean? A lineage means if you're in a well space and want to understand why we decide to drill a well at a certain place, they go all the way back to the exploration phase. It's almost impossible nowadays. Yeah? Because the data sits all in these silos, it's very hard to figure out, okay, I now have decided to drill a well out there, but what is all the information who led to that decision? That's very hard to find out nowadays. Sometimes you wonder how you still do find oil and gas because of all these limitations out there. So data stored in silos, very important. And then metadata stored with the data. Metadata, of course, is data about data. But often we have millions of files out there in the subsurface space with many different file formats, but very poor with the metadata. It's very hard to find out what data we actually have. If you look at your seismic software, if you look at your interpretation software, what actually is the data we have out there? So we have lack of content information. If you sit, for instance, in the case of Shell in Australia, and you want to know what we're doing in the US, today is impossible to find out. Yeah? Limit to no search capabilities. It's very hard to say, okay, because there's no metadata, it's also very hard to say, okay, but what's the search? What data do I have? What kind of fields do I have? What kind of common fields do I have around the world? Again, very hard to figure that one out. And the last one, which is very important, data is not ready for a data-driven world. Because we're really moving from, of course, a physics world to physics and data-driven world out there. Because if you look at our data today, only maybe 10% of our data is actually being used in the subsurface space. The rest is not being used. The data is there, but not being used because the people are not around to make it happen. But with machine learning and AI, it becomes possible that all the data is being used all of a sudden. And that's why this whole part of data-driven applications is very important. So this is the world of Shell today. So I'll speak here now for Shell. And maybe ExxonMobil or BP or Total, whatever they're called, do a much better job out there. But based on experience with the OSU experience, we all have that same problem out there. Lots and lots of data. If you look at a company like Shell, in this space, you find by far most of our data. In our case, it's about 200 to 300 petabytes of data sits in this particular area. And many different data types. And not all structured data. If you go to other parts of the company, often very structured data driven. Here, it's all over the place. You've got structured data, unstructured data, binary data, many different formats out there. So it's quite a complex environment out there, the most complex environment we have. But the current reality is also that we're not in a very good shape out there. Therefore, we cannot just continue, because we are moving to a data-driven world out there. And as long as you have the data sitting out there in your silos, it's very hard to bring the data together and say, oh, now I start applying machine learning to help the interpreter where to focus at. Yeah? That's the first point, because we move from physics to data, physics and data world. The timelines we have to reduce. The times today are far too long to go from shooting your seismic and really drilling a well out there. Data quality is not always very good, needs to be improved. And of course, the access to metadata. I mean, metadata is highly underrated, but so important because it gives you information about data. And without metadata, it's very hard to find out what information you actually have. What makes it challenge out here, that you have so many different file types out there, that the metadata, you need the metadata to extract from every file type out there. So it's quite a complex environment. So we cannot control like this. Yeah? So the biggest change we have to approve is the first one, is really separate data from application and start from a data point of view. Forget about the applications for now, but first get your data store in order. Yeah? So put all the data into a separate data platform and separate the data totally from your applications out there. And such that any application can access any type of data. But start from a data point of view. And look at all data. Yeah? That goes from shooting your seismic to pre-stack, the post-stack, your drilling, your well logs, your borehole data management, any type of data out there will go into that single data platform out there. And the scope we're talking about first, and that will change over time, we're talking first of exploration. Exploration is really the first place. You're going out, shooting your seismic, and do something with that seismic data. Then development, you've now decided that you're going to do something. You're to start developing now your field out there. It's development phase. And wells, basically the phase where you start drilling your wells to start producing out there. So that's the whole phase we're talking about, exploration, development of wells. Together we call it subsurface and the well space. So data the center and support for MetaMaster data, making sure that when you're loading your data into a data platform, that you do extract all the metadata out there. Because that is gold for when you start looking for information about the data out there. And of course, real time. We more and more become a real time company out there. Also in your subsurface space with your reservoirs, we're more and more using sensors to real time collect data about that field. So it's not just a batch environment, more and more becomes also a real time environment out there. But the first point is to put data at the center of what we're trying to do out there. Yeah, this is the most important point we need to do. And for the rest, applications will follow. I'll come back to that. So data at the center and any type of data. If you look at that, this is the overall high-level picture of what we call then the open subsurface data universe. It's both a data platform and an application platform. And I'll explain the calling in a moment. But let's first look at what we call maybe sort of a green calling. It's the center you find at the data platform services. That's where you store all your data. So all the data we're talking about, all structured data, unstructured data, your documents, whatever you have, is loaded via the data ingestion services into your data platform. Your data ingestion services are very important because that's where you extract metadata. So you have your data data ingestion services. That's where you decide for each data type, each file type, what's the metadata I can extract. Yeah? And the metadata, again, is the information about the data itself. Dus in data ingestion layer, you extract your metadata. You also look at the data quality, and you bring all the data into your data platform service. So all the data you can think about, whether it's your raw seismic to your drilling logs at the other end, will go into that single data platform. Of course, this all sits in a public cloud-based environment. I'll come back to that later. So public cloud environment. And of course, you also have your information security out there, which has three layers. First, your user authentication, which is all about who has access to what. Yeah? User authorization, if the user logs in, what type of access to the data does that person have? That's driven by roles and by metadata again. And the third layer, of course, the protection of the hosting platform itself. And then, of course, you got the whole support environment, your end-to-end support and management, your operations, your audit trails, your monitoring, your CICD, development environment, etc. So that's very much the green part. And then you also find the green part in country, because we also operate in environments where we're not allowed to put move the data out of country. Because if there's a public cloud environment, public cloud is not available in every country in the world. Yeah? And we have countries out there where we're not allowed to move data outside country. So we have to accommodate also what we call an in-country solution. It means I can put the hardware in-country to support that same capability. That's our in-country solution all about, is that in-country solution of your public cloud environment. You see here, the green part is the part, so now we talk about the OCU environment as part of the open group. The green part where we as operators do not compete. I do not compete with BP, with Total, with ExxonMobil in the green part. We do not compete how we structure data. We will compete about the data itself, but how we structure data, who cares? Nobody would care about it. So the green part is clearly a part we can work well together. And as part of the OSDU, we are working well together. I'll come back to that, where we are on that. The gray part is where we do compete. Those are the applications. Yeah? Because everybody will have their own set of applications, either developed in-house or purchased on the external market out there. And the red part is a clear separation, the API layer, the application program interface. That's a very important thing out there, because that determines the separation, but also tells you what the applications need to do, how the applications will get access to your data platform layer. But what we try to achieve with OSDU is a platform capability. That we have lots of parties who develop in the gray part, whether you are a startup, whether you are an operator, whether you're a large company, small company, who cares? But every company will develop applications in the gray part, so we create competition out. I'm going to explain in a moment. Therefore, the API layer is very important, because it gives a well-defined entry point, which you cannot just change for people who develop applications. And whether we got OSDU installed in Exxon, or in Shell, or in BP, or in Woodside, or in Petrobras, we don't care, because that application will run in each of those environments, because the API is always well-defined. Of course, different data out there, but the API is well-defined. So all this public cloud-based, public cloud, so no private cloud in this space, apart from the in-country solution. So all data is loadified to data ingestion services, where we recognize the data types and extract metadata from the data types. We have the set of RESTful APIs out there. All applications, we support both legacy applications out there and new applications, because our new applications will all, and I'll talk in a moment, will all be HTML5 microservice based, but of course we have a large number of legacy applications out there, which still often are still Windows desktop or Linux desktop based, and we'll support these as well, because we have to move the migration forward. We talk about security, we talk about in-country, and of course we talked about the legacy environment. So if you're talking about OSDU, it's both the data platform services and the application platform services, and becomes for us really the single and center of truth over there, because all the data, all our subsurface and wells data will move into this single data platform with all the applications on top of that. So that's the overall picture we're creating. So it covers all oil and gas companies, although there's very little unique to this picture. If you say I want to use it also in production, what we have to change is very much the data ingestion service and make sure that also data ingestion services do support the data type being used in the production space. So there's very little unique here to say, well, this can only work in subsurface and wells. Yeah, there's nothing there. The only thing which makes it unique is the support for data types out there. Subsurface portfolio includes exploration, development of wells, and of course we expect this to grow, most likely also into the production space. We now focus at this because it's the most complex part. We need to get it right. All data types, structured and unstructured. Unstructured in this space is very important. Unstructured could be your PowerPoints, could be your Word documents, because often in exploration they put images in PowerPoints and in Word documents about areas of the world, yeah, with certain coordinates. But if you use a typical search environment in Microsoft, in SharePoint, it's unable to find these images inside Word documents. It just doesn't recognize them. Yeah? That means we lose a lot of data in this space because we're unable to find that. So we're also loading that type of data into this OSDU environment where we can extract the images of those PowerPoints and Word documents, because there's a load of information in that environment which today we're unable to absorb. Support for data-driven applications. Very important. Machine learning again. Why is it so important? Because the first time now we can exploit every byte of data we collected. Yeah? And if you need to realize, whenever we do a survey out there, we're collecting petabytes of data per survey. And we do many surveys every year. Yeah? So there's too much data for a normal human being to comprehend, and therefore using machine learning to go through all of that data and start steering the interpreter, say, okay, focus here, focus there, and focus there. So start steering, very much managing, driving that interpreter. Therefore, that data platform for machine learning is also very important. We talked about metadata. Never underestimate the importance of metadata. We talked about the single set of definitions, and of course the API layer out there. So OSDU coverage. If you now look at how that would look like, take this simple shell environment. So although you could say, well, in principle, you could put OSDU in one location in the world. Let's put it in Dublin, because there are quite a few. The Amazon data center sits over here in Dublin for Europe. So you could say, okay, let's put OSDU for shell over here in Dublin. Technically, that could work. The problem, of course, we've got many so-called 3D applications, a three-dimensional application. That means that the distance between your data and your user can only be a certain distance, because otherwise it won't perform. Yeah, and therefore, you see the first bullet point over there, the OSDU location-driven max distance between user and application, often 3-day data. And so normally it's about maybe 40 or 50 milliseconds. That means you're talking about between here and maybe 44 milliseconds is, yeah, well into Europe somewhere, into the continental Europe. Therefore, what you see over here, in the case of Shell, we will be implementing them, these OSDU implementations, around the world. That means every system will have the full set of metadata. So metadata is replicated around the world. Wherever you sit in this environment, whether you sit over here in Europe, in Norway, or sitting in Australia, you know exactly what data is available around the world in this environment. The real data will stay within the region it's been created. Like all the European data will sit in Dublin, all the US data will sit in Virginia, where the AWS data center is for the US, yeah? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And where we have teams working together, we will temporarily replicate the data as well. But the reason for this distribution is purely driven by the bullet point one, yeah? It's the max distance you can have because we've got high intense 3D applications which people interactively use. They're not reporting applications, they're people 8 hours a day are working with that application. So if that is not performant, you get some very frustrated users out there who will shoot you or kill you, whatever they're going to do with you. Metadata is replicated globally. It's very important. Eh? So if somebody in Perth in Australia wants to know, did we ever had this type of field before? Did we have drilling this type of environment before? He can ask that question using search out there, we're using graph out there, and he gets the information from anywhere in the world, but replicated around the world is the metadata. RESTful APIs, every system has used the same environment out there, and actual data stays in the region was being created, like in the US, or in Europe, or in Brazil, or in Australia, wherever it is. Yeah? And of course, it also includes complete the full development environment, CI/CD development environment for DevOps, so there's a full, if you want to develop your own application out there, it's a complete system which includes your data platform, your application platform, but also your full development environment. As part of OSDU, we will go beyond the normal standards. We're not going to say, well, here, this is OSDU from a standards point of view. We also are working with both Microsoft and Amazon, and soon also with Google, for them to deliver an OSDU implementation on their platform. And the first release will come later this year, and we'll come back to it in a moment. So it's important to realize we go beyond just delivering some standards out there. But I don't believe just leaving standards out there, that will be good enough. We need to make sure that people have something they can implement, they can work with, and they can actually make use of. And I'll come back also in a moment how we do that. This will maybe set up for Shell. If ExxonMobil would do something like this, it would most likely be very similar, because it depends on where you got your reserves around the world. If you just operate like ADNOC in Abu Dhabi, of course you would only have one system in the Middle East. So purely driven, where are your reserves around the world? That really drives this, yeah? And everybody will have their own implementation, so we're not sharing them. So OSDU targets very much. Flexible orchestration workflows. The workflows, because the silos were very narrow, they were only workflows within exploration or in development or in the well space. Yeah? Now, because I have the data available across the whole spectrum, my workflow is also covering the whole spectrum out there. So my workflow can start in exploration and go all the way to wells. Again, very important, because we talked about lineage before. Eh? If you're sitting in wells, how do I know, how did I come to that? How did I make a decision that we drilled this particular well over there? Now I can go all the way back to exploration, okay, these were decisions made on the way to come to that decision in the end. And also when in your production phase find out that the field doesn't produce as expected, you can go back again and say, okay, what is different in the field than I expected was be when we did the whole phase before that. Kubernetes support, familiar with that. Asm file driven means I can run on every type of endpoint. It's a fully browser-based environment. Also important, collaboration, because teams often work around the world. The teams work on the data often do not sit in one location, but often work from multiple locations onto that same set of data. Therefore, collaboration, virtual reality is quite important. Physics and data, we talked about it. AI, very, very important, and the reason I gave you. And it supports current applications out there. So if you're using Schlumberger JPEG 12, which is very popular in this market, it's a Windows-based environment, Windows desktop-based environment. Also, that is supported in our OCU environment. So people can still use their so-called legacy applications in what we call a lift and shift mode and lift them across the OCU space. It won't have all the full set of capabilities as a native application will have, but it will run in that environment. And people can then have a workflow which is partly running in the old application and partly in the new applications out there. So what's the business impact of doing this? Yeah. So we have all subservice, which is exploration, development, and wells data in a single data platform accessible via a single API. Yeah, so silos have gone. So I can go all the way back from left to right, from right to left, whatever I want to do. Data is separate from applications. Yeah, the application no longer owns the data, what's really today. If you go to Petrel, the Petrel data is owned by the Petrel application. That also means I'm storing that data in different formats than today to make sure that it's more generally accessible out there. Global oversight of what data is available. Anywhere in the world, I can find out what data, what information is available about wells, about activities, wherever I operate, wherever I sit in the world. Yeah? Because my metadata is available around the world. And the last one, we're creating a world out there where many companies start using the same APIs out there, so software companies can start developing applications out there which can be used by a wider group of users out there. Because if you look at the subservice today, you have a limited set of companies out there. You've got people like Schlumberger, you've got Halliburton, you've got Baker Hughes, you've got a small set of companies, and you have some other ones, but small set of companies active in this space. And because as I mentioned before, it's a very silo-driven space out there. What we do over here, we separate the data from the application. So the data is being handled by OSDU, and the application is now handled by the software developers out there. And of course, we've got a set of APIs being used by all the operators. So if a startup wants to say, I want to develop software for this space, it's now can be used in many different companies out there, yeah, like in the past. So this last bullet point is important. The thinking behind all of this to create a market or create a platform out there where people develop software for this environment, so more users will make use of it. And if more users will make use of it, more people start developing software for that environment. That's something to get into. I always compare it with Salesforce. .com, Salesforce.com, you're all familiar with, has about 3,000 partners out there developing software for that platform. Okay, we won't just get 3,000 out there yet, but the thinking is important. The thinking behind it is what it is. You want to have other people that develop for your platform, so your platform gets more popular, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's the thinking behind the last bullet point out there. Make it accessible. Okay, so this all, if you go a little bit, let's do a little bit history over here. We started in Shell with SDU early last year. So Shell started with the subservice data universe. And said, okay, for this to be successful, it's far better if we can make this an industry solution. Because we are far better off if many people develop applications for this space, so we get more competition out there, more innovation out there. Therefore, we said, okay, together with Philip Young, he's my partner in crime sitting out there, so you can blame the two of us to start all of this. But we said, okay, let's talk to some other large majors out there. We did that in March last year. Then we started talking to the open group in Q2 last year. We had a meeting we called Steve and said, Steve, this is what we're thinking about. What do you think? Can the open group do something like that? Because we need a framework. We need a framework to work together. We can't just work together as companies without a framework. And the open group was that framework out there. And we had our kickoff meeting in Houston, in the Galleria, in September last year. So when we started in September last year with about 9 or 10 operators. Yeah, so Exxon, BP, Total, Devon. So it was about mainly US-based, but also some European ones out there. It was our kickoff meeting for the OSDU. Yeah. And that's where we are now. So that's where we started formally. But if you now see where we are, so this is where our operator members are. So these are people who produce oil and gas out there. And it's not 100% up to date, but it's really relatively up to date. So these are, you see all the IOCs are out there. We're now moving into the NOCs and national oil companies. You got Reliance on there from India. We work with ADNOC in Abu Dhabi, and to get also the NOCs and the smaller non-conventionals in the US also in this space. And of course, we have several supply companies out there. Yeah, we have about 45 companies now who've joined the OSDU since, I would say, late last year, because we only opened it up for the non-operators in Q4 of last year. Also, notice over here, the Amazon, Microsoft, and Google. Why is they important? Because they are important for us to deliver the solution into the field. Yeah. So that's why we already went in August last year to these three partners to say, can you help us creating a solution in the market with an operator like Exxon or Shell or BP? You can come to you and say, please implement OSDU for my environment. Yeah. So these are people, either service companies who deliver service into oil and gas market, software companies, but in total about 45 companies today. So we created September last year, therefore, the OSDU forum under the open group, and we created at that time three subcommittees: the enterprise architecture, the data definition, and information security. That was created in September last year. We had a number of face-to-face meetings where with the enterprise architecture, we started defining, okay, what is all about? Yeah. So we looked at what Shell been doing with SDU. We contributed to the OSDU environment to give them a kickstart, and really started defining with these subcommittees the architecture, data definition. Very important, because it's the first time in this industry that we align definitions. Yeah. If you go to this industry today and ask them all for what's the definition of a well, you will get maybe 50 different answers, yeah, if not more. Yeah. So we're now also aligning that kind of, so that's the data definition work team doing. And information security. We also recently added to that the business model to say, okay, how do we make the sustainable model over time? Yeah. It's important also not just to think about what you do the first year, it's far more important how do you sustain this, also keep it agile and make sure we move fast into the changing world out there. So these are subcommittees. We meet weekly in calls. We've got Slack, very active Slack community out there. And we've got regular face-to-face meetings. The last one we had in January, when alone for the Enterprise Architecture Committee, we had about 60 people in the room for 3 days to define the architecture. And the next one is late June again. So it's a pretty active environment out there. And we need to deliver something. So this is what our plans for this year are. First, we're going to release a demo release of OSDU, release one, in by mid to late June. What does a demo release mean? It's a full copy of an OSDU environment, yeah, as contributed by Shell, a full copy with all the capabilities we talked about. But it is not yet, all the members, so all the OSDU four members can get access to that environment. It's a single environment. I call the read-only environment. You cannot yet load your own data in that environment, but we preload with data. It's quite unique. We found 200 wells in the Netherlands, of all places, which we load in this environment. So we loaded 2,000 wells, in this environment, and with some demo applications. So this is being developed by both Microsoft and Amazon. So both will offer an environment people can log on to, can play with, can try things out sometime in June. Very soon thereafter, sometime in Q3, we come with the full release one out there. That release one, any operator can say, like Devon or Exxon or BP or Total or Equinor can go to either the Amazon or to the Microsoft shop and say, please install in my environment under my subscription a copy of OSDU. And of course, that will be done then. And then they get their own environment. We first start supporting with wells out there. The wells, the first support out there. And then later this year, we also want to add our part of release two, which is not on the chart over here, also seismic to this. Yeah, that's for late this year. But the first release coming out is sometime in June. And the release after, the full-blown release for every subscription have their own copy, will be later in Q3. So what does that mean? This will be a game changer for this industry. Because this industry has been in the legacy for the last 5,000 years and really needs to come out of that. And it has been driven by the move to data. It's time is everything in this world. Well, you know that time is everything with this. When Philip and I started these discussions in March last year, all these players in the same space. If you speak to Total, speak to BP, some more ahead, some are more behind, but they're all in the same space. How do I move from a physics world to a physics data world? Yeah? And make data the centerpiece of all that we do. So it's a game changer. is desperately needed also, because we really need this environment, at least from a Shell point of view, we need this environment to be successful in the future in this industry. Because despite what people say, we still need this industry, we still need oil, especially gas, for many, many years to come to really move to another world out there. It's a platform approach. What's important there is I have a set of APIs which I make available to any company out there, startup company, academia. We already have, like the University of Oslo, member of OSDU, because they develop software for the oil and gas market as well. Yeah? So the platform approach is very important to open up that market out. That's the thing behind the platform. Platform, platform, platform. Data is at the center. Yeah? To support all AI, ML-based applications out there. And it's impossible for this industry, whether Schlumberger or Shell, to solve the data problem on your own. Just not possible. People tried it, failed and failed and failed. What we do with OSDU, we make the data story dependent, fully owned by OSDU, and we need supplies to focus at the applications, not at the data. Because they cannot solve the data problem. We have to solve the data problem jointly. It's very important that when we're separating data from applications, for a software company to focus at the application, the workflows at the microservice out there. We only just started. We started, as I mentioned, with the first meet September last year in Houston. It's, what is it? I don't know, 9 months ago, whatever it is. But we still have a lot of work. We come out with first software this year. There's still a lot of work in front of us. Drive, drive, drive. So, join the club. Because it's quite exciting. We're working well together with both the operators and the companies. We have a very focused team going on to make sure that we're going to deliver in June. And we will deliver in June. Whatever's going to happen in this world, we will deliver. Thank you.
For those of us not so familiar with the oil and gas industry without that background, can you say a little about the kind of amounts of money and people and data involved in the subsurface world?
I mean, yeah, in Shell alone, I think 80% of our data sits in this space. If you look at the whole of Shell and Shell, of course, we are what we call an integrated oil and gas company. So we got the subsurface all the way to retail, and of course now also the new energy business, the home delivery of electricity and what have you. So in our case, it's between 200 and 300 petabytes of data. And so it's about 80% of our data sits in that space. Also, if you look at software development, most of the software development work goes into that space. There's a lot of in-house development still happening in this space because we believe, like other companies believe, that they have skills in this space unique to that market. Mm-hmm. So also a lot of our software development cost is going to this space. So, and I would say, and I can't speak for other one, but that's very similar for the other ISCs out there.
Right, big stuff. Let's see. Can you say a little about the business model that supports the oil and gas digital transformation being implemented by OSDU?
The business model is all about a number of things. And the first one, of course, is freeing up the data, because this world, like every other world, is becoming part of the digital world out there. And digital world, of course, is driven by data. But they have to make sure that the data is available to you. And what OSDU does is freeing up the data to make it available to an machine learning environment out there, which today, if you have it all in small silos, is very hard to do. It's very almost impossible to do, because what's ML all about? Bringing data together and extracting knowledge of that data coming together. So it supports the move from this space, from a physics world to data-driven world, well, say, to the digital world out there.
So it's basically about getting more value for the money that you're investing
And as I mentioned, today, most of the data we collect, we do not read. We do not look at, because it's too much data out there. Right. With this, we can look at all the data and then start focusing. If you're an interpreter, say, okay, if you look at all this data, you focus here, here, and here. You start steering, you start helping the SME, the subject expert, where to focus at.
Okay, thank you. Next question. Are you making any provisions to ensure the right quality of the data in developing this new standard?
I always say I don't bother about quality, just load the data first. But what's important that you don't spend your time trying to solve your data quality issue. Get the data loaded, because you will never solve your data quality issue by trying to do it in the background, in the dark out there. Won't happen. I mean, we tried it for 500 years, it doesn't work. So we load the data as is. Of course, whilst loading it, we have some idea about the quality of data. We'll highlight poor quality, but the data will still go into the environment, even if it's poor quality data. And when you start using, of course, you know what type of data you have, and if the results are poor or not what it should be, you know this poor quality of data, you can also start pointing, okay, who's accountable for that data? Because you only make data quality better if you can point to people who are accountable for the data. And if you don't, and if you try to do it all, but first improve all the data out there, you will never, ever get there.
No. Right. Has the forum considered the use of the Open Group's Open Data Element Framework Standard, ODEF, is that a familiar term to you, as the foundation starting point for the metadata framework?
No, it
if not, there are some people in the room who would like to talk to you.
Well, then let's talk about it today. Let's talk about it today.
So, let's see. It looks like the OSDU data platform would have appeal beyond oil and gas. Are there any thoughts at this stage about other industries that might fit or find this useful, or obviously an evolution of it useful?
Yeah, well, we had, we already spoke to people in the mining industry, for instance. Mm-hmm. And I said the whole model is not unique to this industry. What makes it unique is the recognition of the data types in data ingestion layer, at the data ingestion layer. If you extend that, say, okay, I can also recognize production data, mining data, other data types, I could also use it in the industries. Our focus first to get this problem solved. Our plan is to extend it also to production in the same environment, so then we go all the way from exploration to producing it. But using all the industry is not inhibited, it's purely is the recognition of data type. For us, the whole development, the model is nothing in there that says, this can only be used in this industry.
I smiled when I saw this one come in. What's been the reaction of the incumbent vendors in the marketplace, positive or otherwise?
Mixed, of course, because if you look at the market today, there's one company who offers a similar solution out there, which is Schlumberger with the Delphi platform. But Halliburton is offered, there are no other people really offering these type of solutions. The only one is what I mentioned, Schlumberger. But you really want to make sure you've got more competition in this market, so you really don't want to be dependent on one supplier out there. I guess the bigger companies like the Halliburton will be less enthusiastic. At the same time, these big companies are not able to solve the problem for us, the data problem. And in a way, we're helping all these companies by saying, okay, the data we make part of the OSDU environment, but the application on top of that, you as a company can develop at your own leisure, at your own space, or what have you.
Okay, thank you. And last question. OSDU enables sharing data access, but typically, who are the source data providers and what is their motivation for sharing the data?
Most of the data we're talking about is data we either procured or created ourselves. Right. Yeah, because you're really talking about the beginning of the seismic environment. You either procure data out there or you created data yourself out there. And of course, we're also using external data sources, and that has so far not been an issue at all. But the majority of the data we're talking about is either we procured ourselves or we create ourselves part of seismic, shooting of seismic out there.
Right. We've just had a flood of about 6 or 7 questions all arrive at the same time, so we don't have a chance to take them, but I'll pick one at random. Can you elaborate on how you determine what APIs to support the data models in OSDU?
Yeah, so we've defined the API such that we could, because the APIs cannot change over time anymore, because in principle you have a contract with those APIs. Otherwise, an application developer will have a problem that the application works today but not tomorrow anymore. So the APIs have been defined such that we can keep them pretty static, and it really the change sits in the parameters how you call the APIs. So the APIs are fixed, but we cannot afford to change APIs in a year from now or half a year from now. Of course, then your application developer people really have a problem and will really kill you, I would expect.
Right, okay. And I'm going to squeeze one more in because I can. Has the front end source, wellhead data standard, POSC, POSC, CISA, by Energistics, been of any help to your efforts?
If you look at NSIS families from a data exchange point of view, because NSIS is also a member of our of OSDU.
Yeah? And the open group, yeah.
But also part of the OSDU forum. So we're looking very much at NSIS as a data exchange format, not as a data storage format, but as a data exchange format at the moment.
Okay. All right. Johan, we'll leave it there. And from everyone at the open group, thank you for your passion and commitment, and we look forward to seeing the results.
Okay, thank you very much.